Thank you, Deepak, and thank you for the wonderful video. Could I invite our first panelists up to the stage, please? The first panel. So while they're joining us, let me tell you a little bit about this panel and introduce Mary Ellsberg, the moderator. Now, in the program, it says that I'm moderating this panel, but we were delighted to know that Mary's travel plans changed, and she was able to join us after all. She was actually not supposed to be here, but told me about 2 or 3 days ago that she would be able to attend, so I happily turned this panel over to her, and I think you'll greatly enjoy having her moderate. As you know, Mary Ellsberg is the director of the Global Women's Institute at George Washington University, and George Washington University is one of our partners for this Gender 360 Summit. So, Mary, we're running just slightly behind time, and this panel will end at 10:55. You have till 10:55, and we have one of our colleagues will give you some times just to kind of keep you on track. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Andrea. I'm really delighted, and actually I'm kind of amazed that I got invited back to a gender summit. I was at one in Bangkok last year, heavily medicated shortly after a knee operation. Marcy remembers that. And I don't actually remember very much about the panel, but I do remember that the moderator, James Lang, told me on stage that if I didn't settle down, he was going to give me a timeout. So you'll be happy to hear that I've been drug-free for several months now, and I'm very optimistic that we will get through this panel without any embarrassing incidents, at least on my part. I'm going to say a few words just to introduce the subject of preventing gender-based violence for all adolescents, which is such an incredibly important subject. And 2 points I want to make about this is, first of all, the importance that we are focusing specifically on adolescents in this summit. So often, adolescents, even though they're at the greatest risk of experiencing different forms of violence, they are made invisible because they're either considered children as under 18 and included in discussions on violence against children without really looking at the differences between violence against younger children and violence against adolescents, which is so different. Or in the case of adolescent girls, they're included under the umbrella of violence against women. And we don't nearly often enough discuss what are the specific challenges that adolescent girls are facing as opposed to older women. So I'm really glad that we're just really focusing on violence here, and also with a gender perspective. We're talking about boys and girls, and we know that boys and girls both experience violence, but they experience different forms of violence, and they experience it differently, and it's important for us to recognize that if we want to prevent violence against adolescents. For example, in a recent review that we did at the Global Women's Institute, we found that boys are more likely than girls to experience physical violence, and particularly, as Deepak mentioned, at the hands of teachers, caregivers, and even peers. Whereas girls are more likely to experience sexual violence than boys. We know that at least 20% of girls or women and 5 to 10% of boys have experienced sexual violence. And there again, the circumstances differ. So girls are much more likely to be abused by intimate partners, by dating partners. And we know from the most recent violence against children surveys, even though they address not specifically adolescents, but children from 0 to 18, the most frequent perpetrator, between 50 and 85% of girls, are sexually abused by a romantic partner or intimate partner. So clearly, when we're talking about adolescents, we need to be looking at these issues of dating violence. So in the case of I, who work mostly on violence against women, and those, now that I'm getting to understand more the issues around violence against children, you could really say that girls, in particular, at the intersection of gender and generation, they're getting both kinds of violence, And also the consequences differ between violence against boys and girls. Recently, you may have heard that suicide has overtaken maternal mortality as the main cause of mortality among adolescent girls, which is really a shocking figure. And that also speaks to some of the devastating effects that physical and sexual violence have on boys and girls. In addition to sexual violence, adolescent girls are also subjected to other forms of gender-based violence, such as child marriage, female genital mutilation, violence related to honor, violence related to dowry, and to bride price. And I just recently came back, just a few weeks ago, from South Sudan, interviewing survivors of young girls who have been survivors of violence, and was able to really see this devastating effect of some of these practices, particularly bride price in the case of South Sudan, and just briefly wanted to share the story of you with you of a young woman who was 14 years old that I met. And there, girls are literally at the center of the economy. The main way for families to accumulate wealth is by trading, by marrying their girls for cattle, and bride price can be from anywhere from 10 to 200 cows. And because now, particularly with the war, where the opportunities to acquire cows and many of them are lost, girls are now at the center. It's like it felt like it was a war on girls, because there are cattle raids to obtain cows to be able to marry girls. There are abductions of girls by men who don't have the means to pay bride price. Girls are raped because once they've been raped, they can be forced to marry the rapist without paying bride price. And the girl that I met had been basically sold by her paternal uncle. Her father had died. She was taken away from her mother by at gunpoint, and given to a man who was much older that she'd never met for 15 cows that went to the uncle. She was beaten savagely and raped for over a month until she was finally able to escape. And then when I met her, both men were in jail at this moment. Both the husband who had been beating her, but also the uncle who sold her. And then when I started to get deeper into the case, I came to understand that the reasons they were there were not because of the violence necessarily. The uncle was in jail because now that the girl had escaped, he owed the 15 cows back to the man. So he couldn't get out of jail until he paid those back. The man was in jail for having beaten and raped her. However, his punishment was going to be a fine of 1 to 2 cows, which would be paid to the uncle who had sold her. And in the midst of this, the mother said to me, I have no way to protect this girl. This can happen to her over and over again, and there's nothing that I can do about it, or no way to keep her and her other sisters in school. So it reminds me that there are so many different complexities and that it happens in different ways. So I really look forward to talking to our speakers about the specific context in which you are working. As Ambassador Stott Despoja mentioned, we now have amazing opportunities to prevent violence against women with the Sustainable Development Goals that have not only established a specific target on ending violence against women, ending harmful practices such as bride price and child marriage, but also ending exploitation and violence against children. And much more emphasis is being placed on prevention. And as Ambassador Stott Despoja said, violence is preventable. We know that now. It's not inevitable. And I'm so excited that we have with us some of the leaders in the field who have been now producing the most innovative strategies for preventing violence and producing, very importantly, the evidence that shows that it can be done and how it can be done. So now I'd like to introduce to you the rest of our panelists. First of all, to my left is Hassan Joumaa, who is a community outreach mobilizer from the Women and Girls Safe Spaces Project, Abad Mina, from Lebanon. Secondly, next to Hassan is Upala, Devi, who is a GBV advisor from UNFPA, and finally, Benjamin Omondi, who is the director of Ujaama-Africa in Kenya, And they have been also carrying out a very innovative project which has been reviewed in experimental designs and is currently being, is part of the What Works to Prevent Violence Against Women consortium funded by DFID. So I'm really excited to talk to all of you about this issue. And if you don't mind, I'd like for just one by one, if you could just say a few words about what it is you're doing to prevent violence against adolescents.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you, Mary. I'm Hassan Joumaa. I'm Lebanese. I am the youth representative of Abad in the Gender 360 this year, and for the Men Engaged Alliance. Abad is the resource center for gender equality. It's a non-profit, non-politically affiliated, not religious, civil association that aims to promote sustainable social and economical development in the MENA region, in the Middle East and North Africa region, through equality, protection, direct service provision, and empowerment of most vulnerable and marginalized people, especially women and girls. Now, Abad comprises a dynamic pool of resources, human rights activists, lawyers, consultants, social workers, and researchers, all of whom are dedicated towards achieving gender equality and women empowerment. Plus, Abad now is working with a lot of organizations that are involved into the gender equality and with the engaging men and boys. For now, I'm working in the women and girls safe spaces as a community outreach mobilizer. I go into field. We are having awareness sessions, support groups, parenting skills, info sessions, problem-solving programs, in order to empower women and girls and in order to raise awareness, and also to target the cases that need or would like to go into case management unit. Plus, we have a holistic care by case management, as I said, legal consultants, psychotherapy, and psychiatric follow-up. And we also provide referral for the emergency safe housing. We have like three shelters that can provide the psychosocial support, legal advice, medical follow-up, and empowerment activities for the survivors of violence against women, violence, and gender-based violence. Also, we have the MEN Center, which is a pioneer center in the Middle East and North Africa region, providing free, confidential, and anonymous psychosocial support services to men who have aggressive behavior and issues with masculinities. And for now, under the WGSS programs, we are working, we are facing a problem in engaging men and boys. So we took that chance to work under the WGSS, Women and Girls Safe Spaces, to have some groups in order to advocate for the women's rights, in order to let them speak, because they have a problem in speaking about gender. They think that this issue has not been, doesn't have to be done. So we are letting them to speak about violence against women and girls. And we are dealing with these groups to have a capacity building in the future for having a masculinity program.
Thank you so much, Hassan. Upala, would you like to tell us about the work of UNFPA?
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mary. And thank you so much to the conference organizers as well for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to be a part of this panel. As Mary just mentioned in the introduction, my name is Upala Devi, and I'm the Global Gender-Based Violence Advisor for the United Nations Population Fund. As many of you who work on issues of sexual and reproductive health and rights would know, the UN Population Fund has been in existence since 1969. It's 47 years old now. And we have a country presence in 136 countries. And out of these 136 countries, we work on issues of gender-based violence prevention and response in 134 countries. And we have men and boys engagement programs to combat violence in around 104 countries globally. So without going too much in details, because a lot of what I would want to say would be, of course, available on our global public website, I would just want to mention that the fund works on addressing issues of sexual and reproductive health, maternal health, access to reproductive rights, securing reproductive rights and sexual rights. And there are primarily three pillars on which our programs are founded. One is a pillar on population dynamics, in which demographic dividend and the gender dividend plays a huge role right now, especially in the 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda. The second pillar is the pillar which we all know, which is founded on gender equality. And the third is the pillar on human rights. So when we are, for instance, working in any country program on prevention of violence, for instance, we try to ensure that all these three pillars are well embedded into any prevention or response mechanisms that we have in place. Finally, just to say that the fund works on gender-based violence in both normal/development settings, as well as in humanitarian settings. And right now, I don't want to overstate the importance of working in humanitarian settings, especially as we are looking at the migration crisis unfolding in Europe and how we are having to sort of restructure, retailer our service delivery mechanisms to respond to a crisis which the world hasn't seen since the World War II. Thank you.
Thank you, Paula. Benjamin.
Thank you, Mary. I'm very excited to be here to have an opportunity to come and discuss our experiences in the field in Africa. So again, my name is Benjamin Boyer. I'm the executive director of Ujaama-Africa. That's a Kenyan NGO that is also an implementing partner of an organization whose name I'm going to say very slowly. It's called No Means No Worldwide. This is a violence prevention program that focuses on training adolescent boys and girls. And we currently work in Kenya and Malawi, and we implement these programs across this country. So I'm very excited to be here to basically talk about what we do. So at the core of what we do is we give boys and girls training, and I'll start with the girls intervention. That is the empowerment self-defense training that we give to girls. It starts with empowerment, believing that you are able to defend yourself, you're worth defending, and also equipping them with both verbal and physical skills to be able to defend themselves against sexual assault. We also have a boys component that is a boys transformational program that takes boys through a 12-hour a class around just basically removing the negative gender stereotypes that boys have as they grow up, that usually goes towards perpetuating sexual violence. So we currently work in demographics where one in every four girls is sexually assaulted. I'm talking about the informal settlements of Nairobi and parts of rural Malawi. So we are currently working under the What Works program to prevent violence, and we're also funded by other organizations, including the Canadian government. So thank you very much.
Thank you to all three of you. I'm going to start with Benjamin in the other direction. Thinking a little bit more about prevention and how it works, I have to say when I first heard about the No Means No project, I was thinking, okay, focusing on self-defense for girls, isn't that a little bit like putting the burden on them, like it's their responsibility to avoid violence rather than sort of working on the social norms? However, the findings have been astounding. You've reduced in your programs, the last study showed a reduction of over 60% in sexual assault against the girls who had participated in the program. So clearly something is really working. Could you talk a little bit more about sort of your theory of change of prevention? How do you see it working? Is it literally because girls are now able to, you know, stave off, and are they actually defending themselves physically and that's what's making the difference? Or is there something else going on connected to the self-defense that is reducing the violence? How do you explain it?
Yeah, to answer that question, allow me to take you back to the context in which you're working in. We are working in informal settlements in rural parts of Malawi where we do not have authorities, for example, to enforce the laws that are there. Wow. One of the reasons why girls will get raped in informal settlements is because men can get away with it. So the girl has no chance to defend herself. So we believe that by empowering them, the first, it begins with believing that you're actually able to defend yourself and then equipping you with the skills to back it up. Now, with respect to what works around this intervention, from studies that we've done in collaboration with Stanford University, 70% of the girls who've used our skills actually stopped the rape by just using verbal skills, not necessarily even getting to...
Saying no.
Yeah, just saying no and being assertive, situational awareness, knowing when you're getting into a situation where you're going to be sexually assaulted. So it just starts with situational awareness and being able to assertively in saying no effectively. So the physical aspects come in when everything else fails and you need to defend yourself. So I think when you look at the context that we work in, where the girl has no choice but to defend herself, in as much as we agree that there has to be some kind of aftercare, we have to work with authorities, make sure that the laws are enforced, there also has to be an aspect of what happens if you are the girl and you're somewhere in the slum and you need to defer and you face a perpetrator, what do you do? So I think that is part of it. But a lot of it revolves around being able to know your situational awareness and being able to say no assertively. Mm-hmm. But like just right from looking you straight in the eye as a perpetrator, there is just a certain way that a perpetrator looks at a victim. You're going to be this easy victim, but then if I'm able to be assertive enough and tell you no, I'm not your perfect victim, then it works for us. Yeah.
And I'm guessing if this is similar to other data that we have on sexual assault, many of the perpetrators are people that she knows. They may be schoolmates, they may be family members, they may be intimate partners, you know, boyfriends. They're not mostly probably people off the street that, you know, that are assaulting her. So I'm thinking also just this message you've said that girls believe that they deserve to be able to say no, which is not a message that girls often get, that, you know, they feel like they're supposed to do whatever men or boys tell them to do. That in itself must be very empowering.
We've published three papers from 2011 showing that. Now, with respect to perpetrators, up to 72% of the perpetrators were actually people who were known to the victim. 52% were in the category of boyfriend and friends. Someone a romantic partner. Yeah. So it's not really a stranger who will come and sexually assault a girl. It's these people that she knows. Her partner. So I think, that's true,
Great. Thank you so much, Benjamin. Upala, what about the work of UNFPA? Can you say a little bit more about how you see prevention and how you see that linked to response in the case of violence against adolescents?
I think that's a very important question, Mary, and thank you for asking that. For UNFPA, I think both prevention and response is a very integrated concept, and they are literally two sides of the same coin. And let me just posit an example here. UNFPA does a lot of work through the health service delivery response mechanism as well as the social services mechanism. And if you take, for instance, the role of the health service delivery mechanism in preventing and responding to violence, very often, as we all know, an adolescent girl or a young woman or a woman in general would be seeking some form of health services, especially maternal health services, at some point in her lifetime. Mm-hmm. So it's very important for us to ensure that when you're looking at prevention, the health service providers are capacitated enough to look at some of the delivery of services that prevents further recurrence of violence. For instance, access to emergency contraceptives, access to post-abortion kits, and so on and so forth. On the other hand, the response mechanism also could be the onus of the health service system. And there, for instance, we are training midwives, we are training nurses, we are training primary health providers, we are training medical doctors in refugee camps, where we train them really to recognize the first signs of violence and ensure that as and when the violence is occurring, you respond immediately. Mm-hmm. So to an extent, the prevention response mechanisms are very well integrated in the programming that we undertake. Mm-hmm. Another good example of the work on prevention and response would be the role of the media. The media has a very important role to play for a very simple reason that the media, through its awareness campaigns, through social media, we've been doing a lot right now globally, and all of you know that, in terms of how social media can work to prevent violence. At the same time, the media has a responsibility to ensure that when it's responding to cases of violence, not to overemphasize the issue, to protect the confidentiality of the victims and survivors, to really act in a very responsible way. So again, that's another very good example of how the media has both a prevention and response role, and how we as practitioners, activists, you know, advocates could work through the media to develop prevention response mechanisms. And UNFPA really, through its youth advocates, through the youth parliamentarians, for instance, have been doing a lot of work with the social media to prevent and respond to violence.
Thank you. Paula, when you were talking about the importance of addressing gender-based violence in humanitarian and conflict settings, I think that's really, really important. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, that's probably the most difficult setting in which to do prevention, mm-hmm. When you know the immediate needs are so great in terms of responding to and mitigating violence, and also you have populations who are, you know, completely disrupted, disoriented, and transient, probably. So how do you do prevention in a setting like that?
So as you rightly mentioned, Mary, when we work in camps, for instance, let's take, for instance, the camps in Lebanon, mm-hmm. the Syrian camps in Lebanon, the Syrian camps in Jordan, or in Turkey, mm-hmm. where you first work through the rapid response delivery mechanism, mm-hmm. where you take into account the immediate health needs mm-hmm. and psychosocial needs of the victims and the survivors. You start with that as an entry point. As and when you gain the trust of the communities that you're working with, you start looking at prevention mechanisms. And that's where we work with, you know, work with health service providers, for instance, to run psychosocial camps, to run awareness camps, holding family group discussions, bringing mm-hmm. young men into the picture. And in a situation like Turkey, for instance, what's happening with the Syrian population is that they're not really embedded or contained in the camps. The mothers and the young girls are out in Turkey, in the towns mm-hmm. and cities, and they are very, very vulnerable to violence mm-hmm. right now. They are starting to work at very low wages, and many of the mothers are actually marrying off their young daughters to the local Turkish male population. So we are seeing very different dynamics of gender-based violence occurring. Mm-hmm. And so in terms of the prevention response mechanisms, the way we have traditionally worked may not hold its test right now, and we are constantly having to improvise when we're looking at humanitarian situations like the one mm-hmm. Currently unfolding in Europe, for instance.
Thank you. And I hope if we have time to return to that, to ask a little bit more about the issue of access to justice in those contexts, because at least in South Sudan, mm-hmm. In the protection of civilian camps, rapists, for example, there's really no capacity to hold them accountable, and I think not having, having such widespread impunity and lack of access to justice is mm-hmm. another piece of why mm-hmm. it mm-hmm. continues to grow so much. Yeah. But we'll hopefully get back to that. So Hassan, let's talk about the drivers of violence. If we want to stop violence, we really need to know what's behind it. And so I'd love for you to tell us a little bit about, in Lebanon, what do you see as the major drivers of gender-based violence?
In Lebanon now, we are facing a high humanitarian crisis. That forced a high displacement of people to Lebanon and to the MENA region. So we have now like 4 million Syrian refugees coming to Lebanon, and they are very vulnerable and they are in need. So that had increased their needs, and it's the main reason for increasing the GBV. Gender-based violence had been increasing because of that. Mm-hmm. And there's
is that just among so the violence is increasing just among the Syrians, or
the Syrians now are
the whole population.
Gender-based violence is everywhere. Mm-hmm. But now in the Syrian refugees, they are shown. In the Lebanese, we are not getting into it. They are not allowing us to get into their activities, to get into their life, to go into their mode of living, if you want.
So you're not working with Syrian refugees then in your project?
I'm sorry?
The project that you have, is it working with Syrian refugees?
It's working with the whole nationalities. We have Syrian refugees, we have Palestinian refugees, and also with Lebanese. But Lebanese are not that friendly with us. If you want to work with us in this field, you know, so we are targeting mostly now the Syrian refugees because they are the most vulnerable and the most marginalized people that need to be worked on, and always the gender norms, because we are living in Lebanon in a patriarchal society, in which they have gender roles from the culture we are living in. And usually our society has placed men in a place of power so that they are abusing their privilege against women and girls.
You said earlier that many men don't understand why they need to have these conversations or why this is important. What do you tell them when they say that?
Give us a chance just to explain for you what's the importance to speak about that, because you have a wife, you have daughters inside your house, you have to know how to deal with them, how to solve problems, to stress management, to other anger management you have, not to express violence against them, you know. Because they have a very low social and economical status, by the way.
Upala, do you have anything to say about the issue of drivers of gender-based violence and how you're addressing it? Obviously, it's different from one country to the next, so that's a very complex issue.
In a way, yes, but in a way, no, because it could be different, but they're in a way very similar, because if you're looking at the real drivers or the root causes of violence in any society, you know, it's culture, tradition, patriarchy, lack of awareness, and you know, the traditional gender norms which perpetuate themselves through cultural practices, for instance, like female genital mutilation, cutting, child marriage, son preference, prenatal sex selection, for instance, female feticide, infanticide, honor killings, as you mentioned, dowry deaths, and so on, so on. So that's how they manifested, based on what culture you come from. But in terms of the root drivers or the root factors, they're all similar: culture, tradition, patriarchy, you know, gender norms, which are very much based on traditions and misconceived notions, if you will, of masculinity and norms of behavior.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you. It comes down, the expressions are different, but you know, women in the United States get killed with guns instead of with acid. Yeah. But when you get down to the core issues, they are startlingly similar. Yeah. Benjamin, you look like you had something to say about this.
Yeah, I mean, and allow me to talk about violence of the sexual kind, because that is what I deal with on a day-to-day basis. Mm-hmm. I think to us, rape and sexual assault is basically an issue of dominance and control. Just wanting to show someone that you are in control. I am the powerful one here. So, I mean, that that is fed by, from an African context, very deeply rooted patriarchal society, where we've inherited these kind of norms, and we think that it's okay for me to be dominant around my family. I mean, it also extends to personal relationships, where an act of violence is looked as a way of expressing love for your family members. That if you like, you love your family, you have to discipline them. And sometimes this is physical. So I think it's about dominance and having control over your subjects, as they would call it here.
And when you're working with adolescents, that's a pretty special group, because then it's boys and girls who are really just entering the field of having relationships with, you know, with dating partners and falling in love and all of that. That's where these patterns really become most deeply entrenched, isn't it? So how do you work specifically with adolescents that might be different than the way you would be talking either to children or to adults?
I mean, it's a little different, but I think there's a lot of similarities in the way you'd work with all the others, because like I said before, most of the perpetrators are people who are known to the victim. Mm-hmm. You'd find a stepfather, a relative, a stepbrother, mm-hmm. doing this to you, and I want to connect this to what I said earlier, which is it's about dominance. So they want to show you that I'm the one who is in control. So a lot of the times, what we teach the boys and the girls is that they have to be assertive enough to recognize these patterns that normally lead to a situation where you're going to be sexually assaulted. You're talking to, you have a friendly, an overly friendly teacher who wants to lure you into a situation where you're going to be sexually assaulted. How do you recognize these patterns before it happens? So when you're able to recognize these ploys way before it happens, then it becomes very easy for us to be able to mitigate these problems. So it's basically looking at the patterns that lead to someone being sexually assaulted, and this is special to the adolescent because they're just getting into the sexual active age.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh. Coming back to the question, the point you made at the very beginning, which is that part of what you're helping girls realize is that they have a right to say no.
Yeah.
When you first started talking to girls who had been sexually assaulted or talking about it in general, did you have the sense that they felt that they did not have the right to say no, or that they were responsible if they were sexually assaulted?
Yeah. Every time we asked a girl, do you think you could have done something about it? And they'll ask you, can I be able to do something about it? Mm-hmm. I mean, he raped me, he's my stepfather. So they, in a sense, they do not think that they have skills to be able to at least say no. And mm-hmm. what you're trying to do is that you're trying to give them the permission mm-hmm. to say no, and also give them the skills to back that up.
Yeah.
So that they're able to say no effectively and look them in the eye and tell them, mm-hmm. I'm not a very good victim. So, yeah.
I think even the issue of helping young people recognize what violence is. Just during all these trainings that I've been involved in recently in our research, even in Jamaica, we were training some field workers on how to talk to women about violence. And one by one, they kept coming up to us and saying, well, so, you know, if a boy just does this thing to you, but maybe, you know, there's no penetration, but maybe he does that, you know, is that rape? And we said, yeah. And you could just see that they, you know, it was this incredibly important moment for them to recognize that things that they knew they didn't like or that didn't seem right to them, but didn't rise to what they thought a rape was, especially since you think of rape being something that's done by strangers out on the street and not by your boyfriend or not by somebody you know. I think just this idea of understanding that doing something sexual that you don't want to, that's sexual violence and you don't deserve it, that can be incredibly transformative
yeah.
for a lot of young people.
Yeah, and I think the kind of socialization that we grow up in is that we have to keep quiet about these issues.
Mm-hmm.
So a girl will be touched inappropriately by someone and they will not pick out. So I think mm-hmm. the socialization of the fact that you have to, it's taboo for you to talk about mm-hmm. someone sexually assaulting you, kind of helps perpetrate this mm-hmm. situation. And that's why you're talking about figures as high as one in every four girls in the mm-hmm. slum has been sexually assaulted in the last
yeah.
1 year.
Yeah.
So the silence also keeps these going. But the whole idea is to tell them that if you speak out against these, two or three of you speak about these in your community, mm-hmm. people will know that it's not the game has changed, people have to change, yeah.
And what about the sort of victim blaming? Is that something that takes place in other contexts? Here in the United States now, we talk so much about, you know, a girl's been raped, and we have some very famous cases right now that are in the news where the victims are, or survivors, are immediately asked, what were you wearing, what were you doing, were you drinking, how did that happen, what did you do to provoke it? I think that kind of questioning is also very pervasive. Is that something else that keeps girls from talking about it in Kenya?
Yes, we've definitely observed that in our boys' program, the gender mm-hmm. transformation program, where we initially ask them questions about the normal gender stereotypes, negative gender mm-hmm. stereotypes that boys have. Like, for example, if a girl puts on a sexy dressing, is she inviting you to have sex with her? So it was amazing that almost 75%, over 75% of the boys said yes. And if a girl agrees to have sex with you and then in the middle of it she says no, does she have a right to say no? 80% says, 80% of them responded by saying no, they don't have the right to say no. So it's we live in a society where we're talking about do not get raped as opposed to do not rape. So a lot of these also revolves around blaming the victim, and it's actually boys think that it's the girl's fault for getting sexually assaulted.
Yeah.
And that is what you're trying to address with the boys program, which is your moment of truth. So the boys have to recognize these moments as moments of truth. You see a woman being sexually assaulted, you see a woman with a sexy dressing. Is that a normal situation? What do you need to do? So you have to be the change that you want to see in the society. You have to act and intervene for the women. So as we teach the girls, as we empower the girls to be able to defend themselves against sexual assault, we also train the boys to be able to stand up for the girls and kind of change the negative gender norms that they grow up in that help to perpetuate sexual assault.
Not to be bystanders.
Yeah.
I want to come back to the work with men and boys as well, but I'd like to hear from Hassan a little bit about what are the challenges in Lebanon for working with adolescents on boys and girls on gender-based violence.
Okay. In Lebanon, boys or girls are well affected by their parents. They are raising them about the rigid gender role. You are a boy, you don't have to dance ballet, for example. You are a girl, you don't
You don't have to, you can't, right?
You can, yeah. And for girls, you can't play football. And now in Abad, we have a football team for girls, and they got the champion in Lebanon for playing football among all the girls in Lebanon.
That's so great.
Yeah, it was great to do that. Thank you.
I assume there were other teams and other girls' teams,
yes.
Right?
Yeah, but great. It's a formal one in Abad, you
Wonderful.
Know? Yeah. So they are affected by their parents, as I said. They ask them to do what they want. You have to do that. You don't have to do that. Mm-hmm. And even in our work, we are inviting a lot of adults. We're working with a high number of adolescents, but the most challenges is that parents are preventing them from coming to the sessions, saying that these guys that you are going to watch them are going to lie to you. They are going to say something which is against our culture, against our religion.
Right.
So, yeah.
So are the parents just as protective of the boys as the girls? It's for both? Or is it mostly the girls that they're protective of?
No, both. But mostly girls, because boys, they take the decision of not coming because they are not interested into what we are doing. So as I said, we have a big problem in engaging them. So we are going to them. So as a community outreach mobilizer, me and my colleagues are doing now a home visits, groups in home. To prevent those adolescents to go to the center, which they are prevented to go there. So we are having awareness sessions. We are traveling. We are working with them in order to reach gender equality, and we had beautiful results now.
Great. Do you want to tell us a little more about the results?
Okay, as I said, we had the football team, and the parents all were in the stadium, watching them and advocating for them. We have now committee groups with the girls and boys we worked with. They are advocating for the women's rights. We are having also capacity building projects. We are working with the clinical management of rape. If we have a case of rape, what should we do? Where should she go? How to get rid of the sexual transmitted infection?
Great. So it's interesting that in this context, you really need to work with the families and the parents as well to be able to even get access to the adolescents.
Especially mothers and the family are dealing with their children as if you are a boy, you have to be a man. Wow. Sometimes they tell their sons, you have to hit your wife on the first day of marriage to let her know that you are a man, that you are strong, that you are a boss, you know?
Yeah.
And also the girl and the mothers for the girls, they are raising them against on the rigid gender roles they have.
We actually came across something similar in a project that I was associated with in Nicaragua, where it was with younger adolescent girls carried out by PATH called Entre Amigas. And originally we thought that it was going to be the teachers and the other girls who would be the main mentors and allies, you know, of the younger girls. And we found out through focus groups and interviews that what the girls really wanted was for their mothers to be more supportive. And the whole intervention was changed around. And an additional piece of the intervention was created for mothers about how they could be better allies of their daughters and not just reproduce whatever kind of sort of, in the name of protection, they were keeping their girls from being able to go out. They were treating them like, you know, they were about to do something bad. And improving this relationship between mothers and girls was a really important part of the intervention. Benjamin, have you been also working with parents and families in your work?
Yeah, with respect to that, we closely work with teachers. Again, I must say that our interventions are school-based. We train boys and girls in schools, and normally teachers are really our representatives to the parents. We never really get to talk, to work with the parents directly, but we work with the teachers who are actually the representative of the parents in schools. And a lot of the times, they would want to really show what role that they play, that they play around making, trying to stop these vices. And one of the things that we notice is that girls and boys will not talk to teachers and parents about matters sexual, especially sensitive topics like sexual assault. So in all schools in Kenya and also in Malawi, they have all schools are required to have guidance and counseling teachers whose responsibility is to handle these kinds of situations. They go to persons in these schools. But boys and girls who've been sexually assaulted will not go to these individuals. And I think that is an opposite to what you're talking about. They'd want to talk to someone else who is not an authority. You can't be my maths teacher and then at the same time I want to talk to you about the fact that I was sexually assaulted by my stepdad. So as Ujaama-Africa and No Means No Worldwide, what we do is that we create, we bridge that gap by using our instructors who are very well trained around handling these kinds of situation. So with respect to parents, these are things that, especially sexual assault, these are things that they would not want to talk about with the teachers.
So you're creating alternative sort of role models and mentors that they can talk to.
Yeah, we our instructors are called community champions, and that is exactly what they are, because we recruit them from these very communities that we work in.
Great, thank you. Back to you, Paula. So now we're talking about sort of impact, and two issues I'd like to think about are, first of all, how do we understand success? What is success in this case? Is it really just reduction of violence, or are there other elements that we use to measure success? And then the second piece is really, what is the role of research and producing evidence, and how do we actually know that things are working? And I know Benjamin will have something to say about that. So let's go with you first, Upala.
I think that there are many different variables by which you measure success in any form of programming. And in this case, we are talking about success in gender-based violence prevention and response programming. I think the first indicator of success would be how many women and adolescent girls are accessing, for instance, the health service delivery mechanisms. How many people are accessing their social service mechanisms? How many cases are being tried in court? How many perpetrators are being held accountable? So we are basically looking at numbers. That's the first indicator of success. Because from there, you would look at the evidence base, which would allow you to then look at what the challenges are in your programming and what are some of the response mechanisms that needs to be put in place to improve quality and access, for instance. So that would be number one. Number two would be looking at investing in research and developing the evidence base. I cannot overstate this often enough, but the fact is that while many of us are supporting programs on the ground, what we are not investing in is enough research, and we forget to mention, and we forget to remember that if we do not invest in research, capacity development, and the evidence base, we are not going to be able to develop that evidence base that's going to impact upon policy advocacy to develop legislation and policies, for instance. That's number two. And in terms of what's happening right now, I think there have been quite a few indicators of success again. And for us personally in the UN, and for those of us who work on issues of gender equality and women's rights and gender-based violence, for us the most recent indicator of success would be not just the adoption of the 2013 Sustainable Development Agenda, but you know, having a goal on gender equality, having goals on maternal health, having goals on violence against children, and then having targets under each of these goals that deals with violence, harmful practices, female genital mutilation, child marriage, children's health, maternal health. I think for us, that's a fantastic indicator of success. And now the challenge would be to look at how we pull ourselves up by the bootstraps, us as the UN, civil society that we work with, governments, the member states who adopted the agenda, and how we can all work together to ensure that for the first time ever in history, we have a chance through these goals and indicators and targets to maybe make a difference, hopefully. And let's see.
Clearly, we would not have achieved those goals and targets if we hadn't already presented evidence-based. An enormous amount of evidence.
Yes.
Really indicating how common and widespread and how devastating the impact of violence against children and adolescents and women is. So last question before we go to the audience, and in this I really want to commend both Deepak and Benjamin, because as policymakers, international agencies, researchers, we all understand why we desperately need impact evaluations, but they're extremely, not only costly, but they're complicated and difficult to carry out, and they're a huge burden actually on the implementing partners. So not only just to commend you, but also to ask you, Benjamin, you know, why did you feel the need to get involved in a randomized control trial when you could have just, you know, continued your work and say, we know we're doing great work and girls say that they're being abused less? What brought you into doing this experimental impact evaluation, and how has that been helpful to you?
I mean, I think in terms of really communicating how effective an intervention is, there has to be some science behind it. And I mean, for us, it's a matter of policy in terms of just making sure that we are able to look at what aspects of our interventions lead to the to the impact that we see. We've been able to see a 50% reduction in sexual assault in all the areas that we go to. And being able to prove these using different methods of evaluation is actually very key. Initially, we started with quasi-experimental designs, and we went to, currently we're doing RCTs, and we're seeing the same margin of results. I think this corroborates the findings that we have from our previous studies. But I think the idea is to communicate to the world that this prevention is something that can actually be done, and it's cheap. Why don't we focus all our efforts towards the adolescents? Girls and boys are incredibly powerful with respect to girls and boys. So if we focus all our effort on that, then we...
And I know, I believe you're doing also a cost-benefit, cost-effectiveness study at the same time. So.
Yes.
That is so impressive, and really we're all of us are grateful to those of you who are in the field doing this innovative work and really being open to this very rigorous evaluation and all the hardships that that can cause as well. So now I'm going to open up to the audience for questions. I'm sure there are many. Yes, I think you were the first one. I think there must be, yes, there are microphones on their way.
Thank you. I'm Annie Modi from the DRC. My first question goes to Upala. I commend UNFPA in my country for the great work you're doing. I'm from the DRC. But my concern is your support is actually on the existing health system. in some parts of the world, you still find places where there is no this mechanism at all. How do you develop strategies or programs to partner with other stakeholders, like Benjamin, for instance, to reach out to those communities to prevent and respond to the gender-based violence?
Thank you. Let's take a few questions. Somebody in the back, I don't mean to make the microphones jump around, but then we'll try and get them.
Hello, my name is Preston Mitchum, and I work at the Center for Health and Gender Equity. My question is about really thinking and staying true to intersectionality, and how do you engage and really prevent GBV among LGBT-identified youth and those who are also at the intersection of being women?
Thank you. One more? Go ahead, please, and then I'll get you in the next round.
Thank you. Excellent presentation from the three of you. My name is Camille Saadé. I'm with FHI 360. And I have a question to my fellow Lebanese here. Hassan, I'm very, very surprised, but also interested that you are addressing issues dealing with the adolescent. But also, I was very interested to hear that you have a kind of toll-free for would-be perpetrator, males who have aggressivity issues. I would love to have more information how you are acting at this level in terms of preventing the potential perpetrator, and how does it work? I mean, is it like somebody who is angry and instead of hitting his wife or daughter or neighbor, would call this number? And who would answer on the other side of the phone? Would it be a man like you or a female? How does it work? And how is it working? How successful is it? How many calls do you get in a day, a week, or a month? I have so many other questions.
Fortunately, we're moving into coffee time, so there will be even more time for that. Let's start with you, Paula. The question about what about where there are no services for survivors, and how do you work with communities as well?
As I mentioned at the outset, that our primary stakeholder that we work with at the country level is the health service delivery mechanism. And anywhere in the world you go, health services do exist, however rudimentary or however, at a low level that may be, but it exists. So we will make concerted effort as a part of our mandate to work through the health service delivery mechanism, because there are other UN agencies, for instance, UNICEF, that works through social services mechanism, or you'll have UNDP that works through the police and justice sector mechanism. So having said that, I would also put it on record that UNFPA is one of the UN agencies that works a lot with civil society organizations. Okay. And we go the whole spectrum from research organizations like the International Center for Research on Women to men and boys organizations like Men Engage or Songke Gender Justice. It goes the whole spectrum. And we've realized that one size doesn't fit all. And if you just work through one level of stakeholder, in this case the public sector, the health service delivery mechanism, you would not be able to make an impact. What you have to do is to work at all different levels, whether it be at the individual level, at the community and societal level, through civil society organizations, and at the public sector level, where you work with member states. So we do work at all different levels, and the civil society constituency is one of our largest. And we wouldn't be doing what we do without having civil society as our partners on the ground.
Thank you. Okay, the question about intersectionality and working with LGBT youth, do either of you have anything to say about that?
Yes, I think I would like to answer that question with respect to our boys' program. And one, people were targeted adolescents are targeted for various reasons. It could be their sexual orientation, it could be their economic status and all that. But I think what our intervention tries to address, your moment of truth, gender transformation training for boys, is that we have to respect people regardless of whatever it is the situation is. And talking about sexual orientation as an example. So I think it naturally fits. We do not get these as a, it doesn't come out explicitly or ever so often around areas that we program in, but I think it naturally fits into what we teach the boys and the girls. We have to respect people regardless of whatever the situation is, yeah.
Okay, for us in Lebanon, we're not dealing with the LGBT because for the government is criminalizing people who are LGBT. So it's forbidden to be worked, unfortunately. It's forbidden to be worked now in Lebanon.
Does that mean that there's nobody in Lebanon who's able to discuss it at all? Or does that mean that they're risking their
no,
lives?
It's not
to
about
do it?
Risking lives.
Yeah.
But they are not getting into the goal they okay. are working on. There's a lot of organizations that are working on this, but we are not getting any result. It's still the same because, you know, the culture and the society we're living in.
Thank you. And Hassan, the last question was for you about the program for perpetrators, and is a toll-free phone line for would-be perpetrators, is that what you were talking about? I'm sorry?
What does perpetrators mean?
Oh, perpetrator, somebody, a man who's about to abuse somebody. Perpetrator is like an abuser.
Oh,
somebody
okay.
who's using violence.
So, okay, I thank you for your question. For now in Lebanon, we are dealing with a strategy talking about gender without the G word. I told my colleagues there about it yesterday. So we are going into the session, we are taking a general subject like stress management, anger management, and through the discussion they all speak about gender but without saying the word. So, yeah, this is what we're doing because we need to engage them. This is the only way to engage them. So, and it takes sometimes weeks, months, but during the cycle we're working on, we are getting very good results. And media is playing a very big role in the organization. We have a lot of brochures, we have a lot of movies that prevent gender-based violence, that prevent, that give the ways to resolve the problems without violence and so.
So it's more preventive sort of broadly than an individual calling and saying, I'm about to hit my wife, what should I do?
Oh, no. Yeah. What's happening in Lebanon is that women are coming to us saying that I was abused from my husband, my stepfather, my father, and so. So the judges in Lebanon are forcing men to go into the men's center. So it's very good that we are having that. So they are forcing the men to go into the men's center to get 90 or 80 hours for psychological support, for advocate, for seeing what is the issue with him.
Sort of what we would call batterer's intervention, interventions for abusive men.
Yeah, we are getting help from the government. Yeah, this is how it's working. And they are obliged. If you ask a man to come to the men's center, no one will come because they think themselves they are right. Mm. So judges are, for example, we have a case of kidney failure girl who was hidden from her father because he's paying a lot of money for her medical intervention. She came to the social worker we have as a case management unit, and we referred to the judge. The judge forced him every month to pay like $300 for just clothes and all the things that she needs, and like $300 for the medical intervention, plus going to the men's center to resolve his problem.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I think the point about talking about gender without the G is very much the way raising voices talks about it. I think many of us have found that there's no faster way to get people's eyes to just glaze over than to start talking about gender. So talking about power in other ways, I think, has turned out to be a very effective way to discuss these issues. I think, okay, we have three more questions. There's one in the back, two over there. Okay, so I'd already promised her. We'll do four, the two of you and the two of you over there. How's that? Thank you for calling out. Sorry, I have my back to you.
Cool mics. Hi, my name is Noelle Schroeder. I'm with the Women Thrive Alliance. And my question is specifically to Upala, but I would love to hear Hassan and Benjamin, your thoughts as well. So you mentioned the Sustainable Development Goals as a marker of success in our commitment toward ending gender-based violence. And I want to ask you, one, do you feel that the SDGs go far enough in addressing the different dimensions of gender-based violence, specifically as it relates to adolescents? And two, you also mentioned UNFPA's commitment to working with civil society, and you mentioned ICRW, Men Engage, two really wide-reaching civil society organizations, but how will UNFPA engage, especially with small grassroots community organizations, engaging them in the implementation of the SDGs as a framework toward ending gender-based violence?
Thank you. There's one over there. Sorry, I think we're down to the last ones. We've got two more here. So the rest of you, encourage you to talk more in the conversation. Who was the first person? I think it was you, yeah.
Hi, I'm Kylie Workman-Diop. I work at Management Sciences for Health. And my question is to Benjamin. And I wanted to join Mary in commending you on going through all this rigorous evaluation of your programming. That's fantastic. And anecdotally, similar programs in the US have been shown to be moderately effective. And in the cases in which they aren't, for instance, women and girls who went through the programming and still end up getting assaulted later down the line, we anecdotally see this exacerbation of self-blame, the idea of, oh, I was trained, I should have spoken up louder, I should have remembered that physical maneuver to beat up my attacker and to get out of the situation. And I'm wondering if that is something that you're experiencing or seeing in the girls that go through your program, the ones who unfortunately still end up getting assaulted, if that kind of exacerbated self-blame exists in your context, and if so, is that something you're trying to measure in your evaluations?
Thank you for that, and we have two questions over here.
Hello. Yeah, hi, I'm Santosh from India. I have a question to all of you.
We don't have time for all of you.
Yeah, no, the thing is that it's very essential. The questions to Upala even, it's very clear that whenever we talk about gender-based violence, we have forgot many other genders are here rather than male and female. So I don't know what is, as you are an advisor, I've seen here, so what do you think about the LGBT people in the next coming SDGs from the UNFPA, because as he asked the question for grassroots level organization to support, there is no such in India. We approach many times UNFPA. They say there is no such policy to support the grassroots level organizations, and especially for the LGBT people. So I just want to know what exactly you are thinking. And to be very honest, I know that there is the Africa friends and the friends beside Upala. It is very difficult to work with the LGBT people. That is very also important, and it's very difficult because we did not want to address them. If we start to address them, then today is the presentation supposed to be there, the LGBT ward. There is no meeting of LGBT. So I'm sorry, I'm very disappointed to hear that we talk about gender, but we do not talk about the other genders. Thank you.
Thank you. And our last question.
Hello, my name is Nyara Tomashi Amunda. I'm from Zimbabwe. I work with a nonprofit called Take Your Life Tally. It's a girls and young women's rights organization. But we also work, the colleagues from Kenya, with boys, men, and the communities to make sure that we have a holistic address to the issues. However, in our work, we've always realized that it's easier to work with boys below the age of 14 because they are more receptive to positive masculinities and alternative anger management and the others. Whereas boys above the age of 14 are already in a system where they are trying to prove what they've been taught all these years to say the definition of masculinity and what being a man is. I wonder if you've sensed that in your work, that it's probably sometimes difficult to penetrate the ages 15 and maybe between 15 and 30. We also realize that when men are now a bit mature, they are more receptive because probably they've tried all other things and they are more getting to be more responsible. But that age group, we found it's a little bit difficult. And also, how do you track then that the boys that we worked with and maybe during that time when they were 14, they were receptive. How do you keep track with those boys to see how they actually maybe ended up being in life? Did they actually become responsive or better bystanders or positive bystanders in advancing the rights and the protection of girls and young women or women themselves? Thanks.
Was that directed towards anybody in particular, that question?
The Kenya colleague and anybody okay. who can answer to that.
Okay. So we're now wrapping up. That's yours. Okay. We're wrapping up. Upala, you have two questions about the SDGs. Do they go far enough? And LGBT mm-hmm. community. Benjamin, the one about self-blame and the boys. And then Hassan, anything you'd like to say at the end just to wrap up. So let's start with Upala.
Thank you, Mary. And thank you all for asking these questions, which are very important. I may not have the right responses and answers at this point, but we are all getting there. In terms of the Sustainable Development Framework, I think for us the most major success has been the fact that we've been able to agree on a set of global goals, indicators, and targets that really speaks to some of the issues that were absent, if you will, from the MDGs. The entire work on addressing violence against women and girls was missing from the MDGs, and we now know there's a huge plethora of evidence that suggests that if violence was indeed one of the targets or goals under the MDGs, we would have had made much more progress on the other goals, MDG goals, for instance, health or education or economic opportunities and so on and so forth. So for us, the first indicator of success has been the fact that we've managed to get not just goals on gender equality, health, violence, against children, for instance, in the Sustainable Development Framework, but the fact that we've got 193 member states of the UN to agree to sign off on this framework. So that for us is the first indicator of success. The challenge will be now to work with the member states and local institutions to look at holding everybody to account to implement the goals and to measure progress and lessons learned. So that's number one. In terms of grassroots organizations, again, I cannot overstate enough the fact that UNFPA does not only work with big organizations, big civil society groups, but for us, our grassroots constituents is very important because we work in remote interior areas, we work in humanitarian settings, and for these kind of settings, we know that the role of small grassroots organizations are invaluable. The work that we do, for instance, with faith-based leaders, with religious leaders, with informal justice mechanism systems, with traditional media, for instance, in countries like Fiji and East Timor, I think that's invaluable. And the lessons learned has been that you work with a mix of stakeholders. It has to be a mix of big organizations, and it has to be a mix of the smaller grassroots entities as well. In terms of the question on LGBT rights, I think it's a very important question that we all have to address here, the issues out in the open. And for us at the UN, UNFPA put forward a declaration that at the UN on LGBT rights, and it's got passed, but it's still not a resolution. So for us, it's a fantastic indicator of success. In terms of the work that we're doing with at the grassroots level for work with LGBTs, we are doing a lot of work with transgender sex workers, for instance. We are working with families of transgender people. We are working on addressing issues of violence that the LGBT community and transgender community faces. And that's well integrated into a program to the extent that when we look at addressing issues of violence, both under a prevention response delivery mechanism systems, our mantra really is that leave no one behind. So it means that we work with everybody, and that will be an all-inclusive approach where the rights and needs and access to services for the LGBT community are very much a part of a programming approach.
Thank you, Paula. Benjamin.
Okay, very quickly, with respect to when the intervention doesn't work, Our experience has been actually to the contrary to what you've observed, is that even though some of these girls will use the skills and they might not work, what comes out is that the girls at least go out there and report. One of the biggest challenges we found out is that almost 90% of the girls who had been sexually assaulted before interventions did not report, and that kind of flipped when we gave the intervention. So besides it not working, the fact that they come out and talk about it also helps helps trying to address this situation. It starts with actually talking about it and saying that someone actually tried to rape me. So they used to keep quiet about it. So I think in terms of that, they come out and talk and they did not look at it in terms of I should have done much better than that. Now, with respect to the question around working with age groups 14 and below, that's absolutely correct. We found that it is very difficult for you to work with 15 years old going forward. But what we've done to mitigate that is that we work with individuals that we recruit from these very communities, so they are able to associate with them because they know that is someone's that is my friend's brother. So it's very easy for the 15-year-old going forward to accept what we do. And I think there are also other innovative ways people can do this.
Thank you so much. Hassan, do you have any last words?
No, thank you for thank you guys for hearing me.
Thank you. That's for the wrap up. So let's just give a hand to all of our great panelists.
Thank you very much.